Today we are going to go over the synchronous distributed training with TensorFlow and Horovod, which I have the suspect is where what you maybe most of you are most interested in. So here we're going to start with a brief refresh on the stochastic gradient descent, and then there is a lab that, if you don't mind, I would like to move it to the end with the rest of the labs. And then from that, we are going to see why maybe why we need to do distributed learning. And then I will present the algorithm that you will see that we will use it. And we present Horovod. At the end, I'm going to talk about what is going to apparently to come next in TensorFlow, so natively in this area. Okay.
Are the slides somewhere?
The slides, Guilherme will put it. I don't know, some point. Well, he's coming. Briefly, they will be on the same place as yesterday. Apps, common, UES, TF. Okay. And also, we are setting up a repository with all the examples that will be online soon. So we tell you when it's online. And then at the end, so we move all the labs. At the end, we are going to do this one, which will be a follow-up of the initial one. But here we will do it with two workers. And then we will try some real-life models with Keras and Horovod, and then with Estimators and Horovod, and we see how the Horovod is integrated with different with the two different APIs. Okay, so let's start. So let's say that so a typical machine learning workflow, this is supervised learning to be more precise. We have some data. This is a very simple one. And we want to feed it with some model, or we want to train it. And the first thing we do is we choose a model. So this data is very simple. It's clearly that it can be fit with a line, with a least square algorithm. But this is just to showcase the problem. We will use TensorFlow. So we select a model. We say, okay, let's get a simple linear model. We have two parameters, m and n, and our goal is to find the m and n that better describe the data. Okay. So besides the model, we need to define a cost function or a loss. So in this case, we get the sum of the square, the average square sum, which is you subtract these two, and the lower this value is, the better is your predictions, because this means that y hat, the estimated values, and y, the references, are very close. Okay, so the idea that we want to do is to minimize this. So we can have a look at the loss function. We will do it now, but here. We have to understand that this y is what you are going to calculate with the model, so the predicted values. So if we replace here the model, we have something like this, and we can plot, since we have only two dimensions, the loss in function of m and n. Okay. So if we do this plot, it should look more or less, it should look like this for this simple case. So this is a contour plot. As you see, these values are higher, and here this is the minimum. Okay, that is clear. No, and if our now that we have the model and the cost function, so this is how it looks. We need to define an optimizer, which is the algorithm we are going to use to take to find the good values of m and n that describe our data. For instance, this If we start with a random initialization, for instance here, we get maybe a line that does not describe write the data, okay? This one is, so the n is close to, the value of n is close to the minimum, but m is very shifted. So you get something that maybe has the same offset of the data, but is completely tilted, okay? And now what we want is an algorithm that takes our values, m and n, from here, so some random initialization, to the minimum of the loss. So we want to minimize the loss. And for that, we can use the what is called the stochastic gradient descent, or gradient descent, depending, you will see now, that this is a very simple algorithm, but it's the base of most of the algorithm used in supervised learning and deep learning in general, okay? And the steps are in the simplest flavor of stochastic gradient descent are evaluate the loss function that we defined before. So you, for a batch of n samples, you get some samples from your training set. And this is called a forward pass. So you evaluate, you give some values, and you get some values of loss. So you give some data and get some values of loss. Then you get the, you also give the a reference, it should be a value of y, no? And you compute the gradient in this point. So in the point where you evaluated the loss function, you evaluate the gradient, and you know the gradient always goes in the direction downwards. So you can use it to update the parameters to a new position, which should be something like this in the simplest case. So the parameters, this W represents M and N, of the step T are the parameters of the previous step minus a constant times the gradients of the loss with respect to the parameters M and N, the weights evaluated in the previous batch, okay? And this parameter here is what is called a learning rate. So the larger this parameter is, the larger will be this step here, okay? So learning rate tells you how fast you're going to move, okay? And you can, so from here, if you repeat these three steps several times, you should get something like this. So those are arrows, is it clear? Or is it, I don't know, if maybe it's too small, but those are arrows. So you start in the initial position we had, and the algorithm will find a way to the minimum. So we want to minimize the loss and find the good values of M and N. So if you use the batch size that you use, which means every time in which data you are evaluating your model, you use it a batch size equal to the full training set size, so all your data you pass it every time to the model, you will get something continuous like this, no? But sometimes you don't want to do that because sometimes you don't want this continuity for several reasons, but one can be that in general cases, if you have a neural network that's very complicated, this loss function is not as simple as this one, but it will have, so it will be multidimensional, highly multidimensional, because sometimes you have millions of parameters. And when you have a multidimensional curve with so much complexity as a neural network, it's very nonlinear, you will have a lot of minima, a lot of maxima, and really a lot of saddle points. And then in a saddle point, the derivative, you know, is zero in one direction, and so it's zero always, but in one direction it goes up, no? And in another direction it goes down. And if you have something like this, and you arrive to a saddle point, your derivatives will be zero. And this algorithm doesn't look at second derivatives, so he doesn't know anything about the surroundings of your saddle point. and then it's going to get lost there. So it's unrecoverable. So one solution can be to use a stochastic gradient descent, which is, they are called indistinct. Sometimes you call stochastic this one, but this one is the original pure stochastic gradient descent, which now every time you evaluate your model, so your loss, you will do it in a single sample, okay? You won't use your full training set, but you will use a single sample. And this means that, so for instance, you started here, you evaluate in a sample, so you put your X and Y, and you get your gradients, and you get this direction, for instance. But you move here, and when you are here, you are going to evaluate your loss in a completely different value that has nothing to do with what you evaluated before. So this means that your gradient is not going to be in the same direction like here, continuous, in this case. So the gradient here can be in any other direction, okay? So you will get something in total like this. And even at the end, it won't converge because you will be always changing where you're evaluating the gradient. This is practically something like changing the shape of your loss function. Because as you saw, the loss function depends on M and N, so on the parameters. And if you change the parameters and the data, if you change the data where you're evaluating the loss function, you're changing the loss function, okay? And here you will get a trajectory that looks like this. And this one, sometimes you don't want it for many reasons, but one important reason is if you use batch size, you lose a lot of computing power because you cannot vectorize on batches. So if you use if you pass a batch to your network, you can get advantage of the matrix structure of the data and the vectorized operations, and you can get some speed up. But if you use one batch, you lose a lot on vectorization. So you are not doing vectorization because you no longer have vectors, okay? And what is mostly used is what is called mini-batch stochastic gradient descent, which is selecting a batch size that is between one, no, a single sample, and the full training set size. So something in the middle. And this will make your batch size a hyperparameter, okay? So this is now something that you want to tune. And the trajectory would be something in between of these two. So now you don't have single examples that can change a lot from one to the other one, but you will have something that you will have groups of data. And if the data is homogeneous and well distributed, so not only the data in total homogeneous, but the batches are well shuffled and well distributed, in principle, they should be more or less close, and you should get similar values of gradients, so there should be some continuity in your curve. Of course, it's not continuous, but it's not so chaotic as this one, okay? And it won't converge as fine as this one, but it's much better than the single batch. And the good thing is that you can take advantage of the vectorized operations, because now you have a batch of data, so you can do operations in the full it's the full matrix of or tensor of data. Okay. And now, any questions about this? Okay. Now this is the lab I was telling you about. This is on Jupyter, but I think it's better if you do it later. The idea is you will use the same model as we saw yesterday. Remember when we saw plugging input pipelines to a model, we use a simple linear model, which is exactly this. And we were going to use this one later in the lab, and you will change the batch sizes, and you can see by yourself how the trajectory changes. And this is the main thing. And then at home you can explore a bit more and I don't know, get some ideas of some feel of the stochastic gradient descent algorithm. Okay, so we were here, so we do this afterwards. So as what I was saying, the batch size, if you use a value between a single sample and the full training set, it becomes a hyperparameter. No? Hyperparameter is, so it's called hyper, I think, because it's to differentiate it from the parameters of your model, no? Like M and N. This one is something external of your model. It's something that you have to tune yourself. It's not part of the minimization, no? Okay? And it becomes a hyperparameter, and you have to tune it, and in general, so you take your model and you start trying different batch sizes, and you see how the convergence occurs for all of them. No? And in general, you use values of multiples of power of two, so you have you don't lose buffers, so space on buffers transferring data, and this is something good. And in some point, so if you start with 32, 64, and so on, you will end up in a out-of-memory error from the side of the GPU, because you will feed the memory. Moreover, if your model is very large and you have a lot of parameters already stored on your GPU, you will feed your memory. And here is one solution is to split your data set in different workers and data parallelization. So you will distribute your data and execute the same model in different workers at the same time, but your batch is going to be split in workers so that you can explore larger batch sizes without filling the GPU memory, okay? But so it's something important, this last point. So this doesn't mean distributing the batch size and going to larger batch sizes does not mean that you're going to get better convergence, okay? Because what you will be doing is going from something like this to this to this. So the larger your batch, the more continuous is going to be your trajectory, and sometimes simply you don't want that. So the final word is the convergence, okay? Not, it doesn't matter the batch size. The batch size is something you have to experiment with, okay? And so if we see a single worker like this, so what it would do, you have your data in storage, you read it, you read the batch, as we saw yesterday, you fetch it as is demanded by the GPU, everything automated, you pass it to a model, okay? You evaluate the model, same steps we saw before, you do a forward pass and the back propagation, this means you get the loss and you get the derivatives. With the derivatives you get, well, sorry, the gradients, you call it, actually, it's multidimensional, you get the gradients, and with these gradients, you update the model and you repeat, okay? So you read the whole rectangle, okay? You read again a new batch, pass it to the model, so on. Now, if you want to distribute, there are many ways to do in distribution, no? There is a model parallelization that, in that case, I think right now it requires effort from you coding. Because there is no like normal implementation. It depends on your model. If your model can be executed by parts, so you execute one part in one worker, another part in one worker, and like that, you can do model distribution, and then it would be every model executing the same data, but in different places. Here we are going to use data parallelization, no? Which means you're going to replicate, you're going to do copies of your model in different workers, and all of them, they are going to execute the same data, okay? So what we have to do is to split the batch size. So it's the same step than before. You read a batch, but now you add that you split this batch by workers, okay? Now you have a copy of all of them. So in Slurm, in PCDynd, you would do this. So when you do your SLOC minus N3, in this case you have three workers, and you do is run your script, the same script you run sequentially in a single worker, it will create three copies of your script, so of your runtime, okay? And if you don't do any code inside that will take care of the communication, so these three things are going to be completely disconnected. So they don't know the existence of the rest. And of course, they will give different values of gradients. They have a different data, no? The data is split. This one gets one batch, this one gets another, and this one gets another. And also the initialization of the models. Remember, you start with a random place, the parameters. They are different, so you have the same model, different initialization, and completely disconnected runs, which doesn't make sense at all. What you need some logic inside that will take care of this. For once, to start all the models in the same point. So now you start, you do your S run, they go to the different nodes, and they started, so the TensorFlow will start them all of them with different randoms, and you want something that's going to be horrible, that we will see, that will say, okay, before doing anything, put the same values, the same starting parameters in all the copies, okay, of the runtime. So now you have exactly the same model everywhere. You do the gradients, but now you don't evaluate directly from this gradient. Now this logic, which is Horobot, is going to take all the gradients, is going to do an average, and it will get a single value. This average is going to be broadcasted to all the workers, and now you get a single value, this green, so this one, they are different colors, a single value, and with this single value, you are going to update all the workers, so that they are in sync. So this is what we need to do this kind of distribution, no? The data parallelism, the way we are going to present it here. So something that starts the model with the same parameters, initial parameters, this is only at the beginning, and something that averages the gradients and get a single value out of all of them, okay?
So does each worker get one batch, or does one batch get split up over each worker?
Well, it's more or less the same. No?
Well, if you have a batch of 30, does each worker get 10?
No, if you think it in pipeline wise, you would read, you would use this shard operation that divides the data, and then so you read the data, you divide it by workers, and then you select the batch size that each worker will have.
Okay.
So like this, so it's more or less equivalent.
Yeah.
Okay. Wait, is there one next to it?
Is it also possible to somehow split up the gradient calculation by the columns? At least in some models, you can have some independence between columns, and then the averaging wouldn't be averaging over different sets of examples, but rather over different parts of the model. Does that make sense?
Yes, this is what I was saying before. This is called model parallelism. That depends on your model. If your model, you can do that with your model, you can do it, but Horobot doesn't do it. So that, I think right now, maybe you will need to do it by yourself. So last week in the developer summit of TensorFlow that I was talking about yesterday, they also presented I don't remember the name, but it's something standard from TensorFlow. It's a project that they do model and data parallelism at the same time. So they have different, they break the model in workers and they execute different data on each of the workers, and somehow that works. And you can find the video on YouTube, I think, if you look for it. Okay. Yeah. Again.
I mean, if you say that it averages it out all over all workers and then feeds it back as a single value, then this average would be different depending on whether I run 2, 3, 4, 5 workers. So this means that the behavior of this is completely undeterministic, you know, that you're not going to retrieve the same thing if you run 2 or 3 workers. You understand?
Yeah, exactly.
But this is not necessarily a good thing, eh?
Exactly. It's what I said before. Larger batch sizes doesn't mean better. But you can think...
No, if you say that you say that you parallelize it over the batches here.
Yes.
And your scheme. So you say you have 2 batches. You run them in parallel. You calculated gradients, and then you averaged these 2 gradients.
Yes.
And feed it back.
Yes.
For the next. This would be one average. And if you run 3 workers, this would be the other average.
Yes.
You see that this is purely determined by how many of those workers you have. It's
Yes, but if you compare it with, if your data, you can compare it with, so let's see, now we use a batch of 64, let's say. We multiply it by 3, we have 64, 64, and 64, okay? If you compare that, so it's exactly as you said, it depends how many workers I have, but if you compare that with doing 3 steps, sequential steps, and also taking care that you do a shuffle, also is undeterministic. You will do a shuffle, always depends how the shuffle happen, and your batch, the order of your data is going to be different. So if you do 3 steps, so 64, 64, and 64, you will have something like this, but you do it tomorrow, and you will have something like that, because you will have completely different data. It's exactly what is happening here. But now, instead of doing the 3 things sequentially, you will get the 3 values, so different algorithm, as you say, exactly. You will get the 3 values in the same point, and you will average them. You can see it as now instead of having a single duration so that comes from the batch, you will have 3 batches, and you will average, and you will get a common duration between the 3.
Well, it sounds it's not like only parallelism, it's a completely different algorithm
It's called distributed.
And the next question is, why would you need Horovod for that? I mean, I watched yesterday a couple of those videos from TensorFlow 2.0, and they claim they have all this distributed learning built
in. Yes, that will be the last slide, so you have to wait.
I see.
Okay. Another question? But yes, it's a different algorithm. You have to understand, no? In one, you do the 3 steps sequentially, and in the other one, you get 3 different durations for each step, and you do an average, okay? Okay, clear? So here, this paper of Horovod, it's worth to mention. It's fantastic. It's very good. It's very simple to read, and You can read it, of course. Okay. Oh, before this, so I wanted to. So you know now that this is done by Horovod, the averaging of the gradients and the initialization of the model. This is what Horovod does. But now I want to discuss a bit how this average happens. Okay. And before going to it. I would say the operation that is done to do the average is called all reduce. That's an operation that comes from the MPI standard, and the MPI standard only says that reduce is you get a set of arrays of values, you reduce them, and you broadcast them to all the workers again, no? So there is not a single implementation of the all reduce. There are many ways to do the implementation depending on the problem, okay? And if it's not clear, reduce, so the reduce operation in general means, so beyond MPI, means getting a small, less values from, no, sorry. An example would be if you have an array, no, a reduce operation could be taking the norm of the array or taking the sum of the values. It's from a set of value, reducing to a lower number of values, okay? In this case, it would be you have the gradients. So the gradients is, you can see it as an array of the gradients of the first parameter, the second, like this, okay? Set of values. And with that, the reduction operation that you are going to do is column, so component by component, you will get an average, and from a set of gradients, you will get a single set of gradients, okay? It's clear? So which is what you see here, no? You have three gradients, and you will reduce it to one. And the operation you're going to use is summing and dividing by the number, and the whole thing is called all reduce, okay? And this, it can be implemented in different ways. For instance, if you have some application that has a main rank, a main thread, and maybe most of the operations are done there, maybe sometimes it will send all the values you want to reduce to different workers. He will do all the workers will send it to him. This main worker will do all the reduction himself, and he will send it back. So this is one way to do it. Other way to do it is what is called ringle reduce, which is what Horovod does. This is something that was implemented first by Baidu. Oops. Which is it's a company that they do things on AI among other things, I guess. And so they come up with this idea, and I will show it here. So the thing is, those are the workers you are doing the calculation. See, I put works for some specific reason that you will see now. So here you have the gradients that you compute on the first worker. So those are the values of the gradient, let's say. Normally it's not 8, but it's more, but anyway. Here are the values of the second gradient, first gradient, second gradient, and third gradient, okay? And what you want to do is to get a single value out of them, which will be the average, okay? So for that you use the ringle reduce, and the first thing of the ringle reduce is the communication is not going to be the full gradients, so the whole thing. Remember, this is big. We are talking about sometimes millions of parameters. The whole thing is not going to be sent at once, but it's going to be divided in chunks. So if there are four workers, there will be four chunks. If there are n workers, there will be n chunks. And now every communication will be done by chunks. So here, if worker 0 sends to worker 1 data, it will send only the green, or the blue, or the yellow, or the red, okay? Not the whole thing. And the other important thing of the ringle reduce, which why is it called like this, is because each worker is going to be connected only to two workers. And also not only connected, but it will follow some direction, no? So worker 0 only will send data to worker 1, and worker 1 will only send data to 2, and worker 0 will only receive data from worker 3. And worker 1 and worker 3, they never are going to be connected, and these two, they are never going to be connected. So it forms like a ring, okay? So now we do the communication, and so look here at the green, for instance. In the first step of communication, there will be several rounds. In the first step, each worker is going to send the index of chunk, okay, to the next one. So for instance, zero, the worker zero, here is going to send to the one his values, and it's going to add. So before you had in the one, so we're looking to the green, no? We are looking to the green. We have 65 and 18, and now it will send and sum and add operation, and you will have now in the worker one 70 and 22. Okay. So the rest of the worker one, as you see, it didn't change. It's the same. Only the green chunk changed. Okay. Now if you do the same happens. So the same happens with the worker one. So the worker one will send the chunk one, so the gray one, to the blue one to the second one. So before you have in the second one you have 7 and 5, and now you have 27 and 26. Okay, so you do another operation, and this is repeated, and all of them change it only one chunk. And now, so this is the first step. Okay, sorry, I am lost on step. Okay, so this is the first step. So the second step would be, the last thing a worker received is going to send it now. So at the beginning, it can be as you want, but it selected the chunk zero on the worker zero, chunk one on the worker one. The second step, whatever chunk a worker received is going to send it to the next worker. So now the zero first receive the red, no? And now it's going to send the red to the one. Okay? Now you have 50 and 5 in the one, in the red, and now you have 65 and 30 in the one red. Okay? And now the same for the worker one. The worker one received the green chunk, and now it's going to send it to the worker two, and so on. Okay? And like this, you repeat again the operation. But if we go back and we start with the worker zero, so the green went to the worker one in the first step. In the second, it went to the worker two. And in the third one, it went to the worker three. So this means that everything that you need to sum is already here. No? 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 So the green, look at the green. So in the first step, it went from the worker zero to the one. Now the one has zero plus one. The second step, the green is in the worker two. Now the worker two has zero plus one plus two. And in the last step, in the three, you have in the worker three, you have zero plus one plus two plus three. The same happens with all the colors, of course. So in general, if you have to do the sum, if you have n worker, you need n minus one, laps, rounds, to do the all the sum to get the values. And now from now on, you only need to send, okay? So now we are here following the green. So now the three receive the green and will send it, no add, because it's already completed the operation. It will send it to the worker zero. So you get in the worker zero the value, and the last one that received was the yellow. Now we will send it to the one, and like this. And the same, you do it three times, and you will end up that with all the workers have the same value, okay? And now you did also three more operations, no? So you do the lap. And in general, is you do n minus one operations of add and n minus one operations of send. So you do two n minus one operations in total in the ring or radius, okay? And this is clear? And now, in summary, so we do this, 10 minus, 2 n minus 1 operations. So the first ones are add, the second are sum, they are send. And in total, the amount of data that is transferred, you can see that is 2 n minus 1, the number of transfers that you do. times the size of the array, so the full thing of the all the gradients of the full model divided by n, because you always send chunks of data, you never send the full thing. And then so for large n, n minus 1 and n is more or less the same, so you get that the n's have no role here, and in total the amount of data doesn't matter how long is your, how many workers do you have, the amount of data that you're going to transfer always in the network is going to be constant. Okay? That is compared to if instead of doing the ring thing, you send all the workers, all the workers send data to the worker zero, for instance, to do the operation there and then broadcast them, what you will have? You will have 2, n minus 1, you have 1 send all of the workers, 2n minus 1, because the 0 is not sending, 2n minus 1, n minus 1 sending, doing the operation, n minus 1 coming back, so 2n minus 1, but now the array size is the whole thing, so you don't have this n here, unless you do something smart with chunks, but then you will increase this number of operations. And then if you do this like that, now you don't have the n, your amount of data is going to depend on how many workers do you have. And if you have too many workers, you're going to create a problem with the bandwidth, because maybe you're going to surpass it, okay? And this is why the ring or reduce has been adopted as a general algorithm to do this operation of averaging the gradients. Okay, so this on Dynd, so you have an idea. In Dynd uses the network is, if I say something wrong, maybe Guilherme can rectify. It's called Aries Interconnect. This is something developed by Cray. It's a very efficient, very high speed. And the topology, all the, by the way, we're going to visit the machine room later this morning. The topology is called Dragonfly topology, and this is the way the nodes and the cabinets are organized and connected. And there is something called electrical group, which is two cabinets, 384 nodes. And inside of one electrical group, you will have all these nodes. They are connected directly one to the other one. There are no switches, so it's just a cable that goes from node to node. And if you go over this amount of nodes and you need to do communications between different electrical groups, you will pass by switches, you know, by some device that will take care of that. And that, of course, that can be a bit slower, although extremely fast anyway, in the Aries Interconnect. And if you really need to, you want to have a single electrical group, you can use this option on your script, so minus minus switches equal one. This means that this is the maximum number of switches that you will use. So with this flag here, it means that the communications or the nodes you're going to get in your allocation, they are inside of an electrical group, of a single switch, okay? And so you can find more info on the user portal. So this is a link to a page that they explain of these kind of things. And now, Horovod. So I already mentioned Horovod. I think I copied this exactly from the repository. So Horovod is, as you know now, is a backend for doing communication. So it will take care of initializing the weights at the beginning and doing this ring or reduce and get a single gradient out of the rest. Okay, and it has now working for TensorFlow, Keras, of course, PyTorch. And I think shortly it was added MXNet, which I think is from Apache, something with Spark. Not really sure what is it, but maybe it's worth to have a look if they already included it. That's it. So it's something standalone. It's developed by Uber. And well, it's intended to do the things very easy, and you will see now why. So one of the strong points of Horobot is that you need a minimal code modification in your with respect to your regular TensorFlow code. So you will add a couple of lines, well, four lines, and with that you will be able to do all the things, which at the end, if you see, it's not much. It's reinitializing the weight and doing the average, okay? It uses very optimal bandwidth protocols, so it will take care, it will take advantage of your network if it is a fast network. And it right now it integrates with Cray MPish, which is the MPI distribution we use on PeaceDyne. It automatically integrates with that, there is no problem. And also with the NVIDIA Collective Communication Library, it's called Nickel 2. The 2 is a version that you can do multi-worker operations. Also, Horobot is actively developed. They are constantly doing releases and bringing new things to the package and doing optimization. And it has a community. Somehow, it's not like as TensorFlow, but at least you can find information about it on the internet on Stack Overflow, so you're not alone if you're using it. And this is very important. So, just briefly here at CSCS, the current implementation we have, we are using this NVIDIA Collective Communication Library, Nickel, for doing the ring all reduce. So we're not calling MPI, so with MPI, which is at the end, well, I guess it's related to a room somehow. So it's run, it's going to create all the workers. When you do as a log n minus 4 like now, you do as run, you will divide all the workers as we saw on this diagram before. And when you do, when Horobot does the ring all reduce, you will be calling this Nickel. So Nickel is not really a replacement for MPI. It doesn't have something like MPI run, but it has many operations, I'll gather, I'll reduce, broadcast, that are tuned for machine learning workloads. So dealing with a large amount of data, okay? So to run Horobot on PeaceDyne, so here you use, of course, the GPU partition, you set the number of nodes, task per node 1, you will use on PeaceDyne one worker per node. So one worker would be one GPU. So since we have only one GPU, we have one worker for GPU, okay? And there is not much to do to run it. So you load the Horobot. This one is going to load, of course, the GPU. Horobot is going to load the TensorFlow automatically and Nickel and everything you need. And here you see that we call it Horobot, the version of Horobot current that we have. And here the TensorFlow that is associated with it. So each, when you store Horobot, you need to give a specific directory. This TensorFlow is not something that you can plug. So for every TensorFlow installation, you need to build the Horobot, no? This one is the latest which we have now. So you set up OMP NUM threads, pretty usual. And now you can set up these three things, which is always the same. And the first one is just about printing things, and you can see if he's using the right network. Just this information about the communication. It's just at the beginning. It won't pollute your log. This one is the interface, the network interface. This one, I think it will find it. It will find it right if you don't say it, but. Somehow it won't use the same protocols if you don't specify it. So with this one, doing this specification, we got the largest, so the highest throughput and the highest communication, okay? And the last one is to use, this means InfiniBand CUDA support, which I think is about GPU direct, which is doing communications from GPU to GPU directly without passing for the through the host. So directly accessing memory from one GPU to the other one. Right now, this is not supported with Nickel, but I don't know, it can be supported anytime soon, so it's something to take in account. If you go to Nickel, you will find 100 environment variables, but this one are the most important that you can use. With this, you should get all the performance that the network provides, okay? And now it's run Python, my script. So this will take care of doing all the duplicates of your runtime. And then the rest, Horobots takes care inside. So the rest is inside of your script, okay? And now let's see briefly the four steps that you have to do with Horobot. So the first one is, well, of course, import Horobot. You import it like this. So inside of Horobot, if you do a less in the installation of Horobot, you will see that there is a folder called TensorFlow, a folder called a folder called PyTorch, Spark, so which is for all of the backends that it has. And then this TensorFlow doesn't mean that TensorFlow is inside of Horobot. It's just the backend he will use. Then you say import Horobot .tensorflow as HVD. This is the abbreviation that they use. If it would be PyTorch, you would say import Horobot .pytorch as HVD, okay? And of course, you have to import TensorFlow apart. And then you do HVD init, and this will initialize all the communications and all it needs to do the operations. And something that's very nice is here you don't need to give any information to Horobot the external and create environment variables and a whole setup just to tell Horobot where he is. So here you say that, and this happens automatically. This is something great. So the same with Keras. So instead of using a TensorFlow API, you use the TF Keras API. You would use now from Horobot TensorFlow Keras. So inside of the folder Horobot, there is now a folder Keras that is what you have to import. And again, this one is constant for all of them. Okay. So the second step is synchronizing the initial state of the workers, which I already mentioned, but more or less this is what happens. No? When you start a calculation, you just run Python, my script, the initial values of your model, so the initial, so let's say it's M and N, the initial values of your parameters, of your model parameters, are random selected. So one worker will start here, and the other worker will start here. No? If you start doing the all reduce from starting from here, you will get gradients, no? And now they are different, of course, because they have they are in different places and they have different data. But now, if you do the average, what is going to happen? They are going to move in the same place, no? The same direction, but they are starting from different places. So they will move. Now you will get the next one, and they will move. And what you will get is something that is two workers moving in parallel. And of course, not going to the center because they are completely misguided. No? And then what you need to do, well, not you, Horobot, is put them together. So now the workers are in different places. It will say, okay, get, there is one, there will be one direct, one command that it will say, okay, the worker zero, send all the parameters to the rest of the workers. So this is just at the beginning, okay? And then all the workers will start in the same place, okay? And now, so the values from now, they are just, I did it with the mouse, it's not real numbers. So now you do the first step, You get it, remember, two batches, split it, they are different. If the batches are different, then the gradients are going to be different, okay? So the gradients are different, you get one gradient in this direction and the other in this direction, exactly what you were mentioning before. And now, in this algorithm, you take the average of both of them. And you move with this average, you move your two workers. Remember, this is not one worker, there are two workers, one on top of the other one, and so on. So the next one will be the same thing, and so on. And like this, the gradient descent is going to advance, okay? This is done with code in TensorFlow like this. You declare this hook, you said hook inside of a list, and you use this whole thing, broadcast global variables hook zero. So broadcast global variables is exactly what I said. Now it's take all the variables, no, the parameters, what is going to be minimized, from worker zero, which you specify here, and send it to the rest. I guess you can put here any number, but in principle zero is as fine as any other. So it's just a single line, and you say hooks, and you pass it in the monitor training session that I presented yesterday, remember? That I said that is what we need to use for doing hooks. So now you pass this hook. A hook is a function that is going to be called at some point by another function. No? So you're passing a function here, and when you pass this, the monitoring training session is going to do the initialization of your parameters. But right afterwards, it's going to get all the parameters from the rank zero and send it to the rest of the ranks. And now you will have to this thing of that all the ranks are starting on the same point. So if you do that, so this is a TensorFlow in general low level API. If you do in the estimator API, you use the same Horobot function, but you have to declare, you will see examples in the hands-on, you have to declare an estimator, which is something that happens like this, if you haven't seen it. You create the hook, and then you pass it not to the monitor's training session. In the world of estimator API, there is not monitor training session. So what you have is your estimator, you have the method train, and you can pass the hook to the hook that you created to the train. So if you have more hooks, you can put all of them together, okay? So this is again another function that in the under the hood, it will have a monitor training session that is going to pass the hook, and it will do the syncing of the initial parameters, okay? And finally, with Keras, you don't remember, you import Horobot as TensorFlow, Horobot, TensorFlow Keras as Horobot. It's a different, slightly different API, but the same reasoning, very similar to the estimator API. You will use a callback. The hooks are calling Keras callback. They are, I think it's the same concept. And here it's called broadcast call variables, global variables callback, zero, the same operation. And you will pass it as a callback in the fit method of your model, no? After you do the compile and this kind of thing. There will be an example again. And so the third thing is that all these ranks, they will be writing checkpoints somewhere. In general, I think if you don't set any explicitly the checkpoint directory name, they will go to some different folders on TMP. But if you need, but that you lose it, okay? No? But if you need the checkpoints and you write a name, they are going to write on the same place. And to avoid that, you have to do the declaration of the checkpoint like this, if Horobot rank, and this is a good moment to say what is rank. Rank is the, so you have different copies of your runtime. So the first one, in the first one, you will have the value of HVD rank zero. In the other one, HVD rank will be 1, and so on. This is pretty common. In MPI, it should be the same thing. And then you say, if the rank is 0, save it with this name. And the rest, I don't care. Because they can go to TMP. Or I don't know if you care somehow. You can, instead of doing this, you can put somehow the rank inside of the checkpoint name. And you can save all of them. But in principle, if you do this, should be fine, because when you restart with the values from this checkpoint, and if they are in the rank 0, they are going to be broadcasted to the rest of the rank, so it should be fine, okay? So this is common for all of the APIs, okay? And the last point, and you see 4 things only, with TensorFlow, so we did already the synchronization of the initial state. The other thing we need to do is only the average. So if you select your gradient, your optimizer, no? Before we choose a stochastic gradient descent, but in principle, this is something else that you have to try. I don't think the stochastic gradient descent is used plainly on any real life code, but you use modifications of it. If you use this, you will start at the same point, but if you don't do the average, they are going to just to diverge. No, they are going both to the same place somehow, but they are completely unrelated. They don't know the existence of each other. And now what you do, you select your optimizer. This is pretty common on TensorFlow. And now your optimizer, you pass it to Horobot distributed optimizer. And now he will use the same optimizer you use here, but he will add the synchronization. So it won't change the algorithm you're using to optimize, so to do the optimization. It only will add the average, the ring or reduce operation, and the fact that all workers are going to be updated with the same value of gradients. With Keras, it's exactly the same. You use a different API, but exactly the same thing. You select your optimizer, and you pass it to Horobot distributed optimizer. And that's it. With that, you got TensorFlow distributed with data parallelism. Okay, it's very simple, 4 lines of code. Of course, this is for typical workflows of reading data, what I showed before, reading data, doing calculations. And outputting. So if you have something uncommon, like some of you that I talked before, maybe that can be, you really need to think how to do it, no? But this is for a typical work case, okay? And those are some benchmarks that we did on PSDynt. So TensorFlow provide this. This is a repository on GitHub that I think everything is about convolutional neural networks. They have many models, and you can choose. There is a script with a lot of command line options, and you can use it in your own system. And you can try a lot of tuning, and one of the things is you can do very simple, very easy, so with Horobot and TensorFlow. And here we selected these 3 models, which are they are pretty common, they are quite popular, very famous, and we selected because the benchmark of Horobot, if you go to the paper, is the same model, so just to have an idea and compare. So this one is ResNet, it's a residual network. If I'm not mistaken, it's a convolutional neural network, but the connection between layers happens in such a way that some layers are not connected to the consecutive. Some layers skip one layer and go to the next one, and there is something like this, okay? So some fancy way to connect in order to have a lot of very deep network. Otherwise, if you have something very deep, you can end up with 0 gradients, because multiplying too many gradients, that there are small or gradient explosion if you multiply something that is very large. And this one is something fancy smart, actually, to be able to have a lot of deepness, a lot of layers, okay? Inception is exactly the same thing. And the difference is that, if I'm not mistaken, in general, the traditional convolutional neural networks, you would do a convolutional operation. You have to define a certain size of the operation of the convolution. And you do one size of convolution in one layer, a different size of convolution in another layer. But with Inception, you will use somehow different size of convolution on the same layer. Then you have, with that, they manage to have also a very long, very deep network. And also it has different exits, outputs, not only one. It's a pretty sophisticated thing also. And this one, VGG16, I think it's from Google, but now I don't remember very well. It's something a bit more traditional. It's not so deep, but it has a lot of parameters. It's quite wide and not so deep, okay? And here you can see how the things make sense now. So these two, they scale pretty good. This one not so much. And so our interpretation is that in these two, you have many operations, because every vectorial operation is done layer by layer, okay? So if you have a very deep network, you have many operations to do that not concurrently. You have a lot of operations, and you don't have, since you have this sophistication of the connection of the layers, they don't need as many parameters as this one. And so you have a lot of computing time and less communication. Well, less communication, no. Less data transfer, because you have less parameters than this one. And this one, you have many parameters. You have a huge amount of parameters, but the network is not so deep. So you can do vectorial operations on the layers. So they are so very wide. But you don't have to do many consecutive operations. So here, the ratio amount of data transfer, since you have so many parameters, with respect to the amount of computation it needs, is not quite even as in these two. So you have a more load on the communication. Here, that's why here we think it doesn't scale as good as this one. But anyway, you can go to almost 3,000 images per second. This is pretty good in 512 GPUs. No? And anyway, until here is quite nice, 24, 32. And so this is something that you can do as well when you start developing models or doing some research. And you can understand better your model, and you can see also how it's going to work on PSDynt, okay? Some additional considerations. We are almost finishing. You have to be careful. We talked a bit about this yesterday. Well, no, sorry, about this one. You have to be careful that your data is split equally. This means that, let's say you do a filter in your pipeline, no? And if the data that's going to one worker somehow contains some kind of data that of items that disappear with the filter with respect to the other one, maybe here you disappear 150 items, and here you disappear one. So this worker is going to need more time to compute than the one that many things were taken out, okay? And like this, you will have a lot of load on a single worker, and one worker do something quick and has to wait, because the gradient of the averaging is synchronous operation, so there's no way to do it asynchronously. Well, there is a way, but the robot doesn't do it, and also in this algorithm, you don't want it. So you want to have the same load as possible in all the workers, okay? So you have to be careful with that. This one is what I was saying that we discussed yesterday. Maybe you can do the splitting operation with the shard on the pipelines in such a way that some data comes from some workers only have to look a set of files, and not all workers look into the same file. If you can do it, of course. If your data is different, you have the data set of dogs in one side and cats in one side, you don't want that, no? You want all of them looking at, so reading from all the files, no? And so this is this. So if that happens, you are training one worker in dogs and one worker in cats. And when you do the average of this to get the gradient, this is going to be just nonsense. The convergence is going to be, well, maybe it's not going to be even convergence at all, okay? It's going to be bad. So this is something to take care. And there are a lot of optimizations you can do in your code. And one that is very common that I put here, that you will see if you go to an example of a robot from the internet, is this, the learning rate. So in the when you select your optimizer, remember the learning rate is the step how you advance, no? The size of your step in your trajectory. The learning rate, they multiply it times the number of workers. And this is similar to Horobot rank, that you have 0, 1, 2, but this one will give you the number of workers. It will be the same everywhere, no? So they multiply this learning rate by the times the number of workers. And here we can see briefly how is it. So you can have a look later, and also you can read the paper. It's a very nice paper and very useful if you are decided to use this algorithm. So we saw this equation before. This is the loss, no? This is a sum over all the losses in your batch. So if you do one step, that we also saw this before, the step t plus one is the value of the t. Sorry, the parameters in the t plus one is the parameters of the t minus, no, the gradient, okay? Evaluated on the previous batch times the learning rate, okay? So this sign here depends on how you take it. So you always want to go down, no? If in general your loss is so this value is going to be down, it's going to be negative. So you have to put this. It will be a plus. It depends how you define your loss, okay? And so if you do so the same thing. So if you put this inside of this equation, since the derivative you can change it by the sum operation, you will get something like this, okay? And now, if instead of one step, you do k consecutive steps, no? What I was comparing before with the splitting of the batch, you will have this update here k times, okay? You will have now a sum over all the batches that you did and evaluate of the gradient. So you will have k times n elements, no? And now if you compare that with the, maybe this is helpful for you, if you compare that with doing the split in one shot, so distributed, you will have that in the distributed, everything is a, you can call it a single batch that is just distributed, but here the number of the whole operation, it's a single operation in k batches, you will have the sum here. So instead of n batches, no, in your single operation, you will have kn batches, okay? And now here in this division, in the average of this thing, you will have kn now. And now, if you see these values, they don't have to be the same. This is just very, very extremely ultra empirical. It's just to have an intuition. The derivatives, they may be more or less similar, maybe not. But the point is that here you have kn elements, and here you have kn elements, no? But here you have the training set divided by n, And here the training set is divided by n times the number of workers, the number of batches. So what they did recommend, and they tried, and was a very good optimization in the code, was to multiply n times the number of workers. So this is learning rate times robot dot size, and like this, so this one cancels out, and you get a similar value in total here for the update. And they more or less they call this, that very empirical again, that your update here in parallel, in so distributed, is more or less in the same size that an update that you would do doing n batches consecutive. But so, okay, this is very empirical, no? So that you have to try, it's some optimization you can try, not something that you can do for sure. And they, so this paper, by the way, is it's called Training ImageNet in 1 Hour. So this database I told you about yesterday, is 40 million of images. They managed to take it, I think, from weeks or week range time to 1 hour, doing data parallelism, exactly what we are showing here, and this thing here. And you can read the paper, and there are many things that you can learn. It's quite interesting paper and very simple to read. And now, just before finishing, I want to talk about TensorFlow native distribution strategy, which is called distribution strategy by them also. And so from the 1.12, if I remember right, they bring this the same operation that Horobot does to TensorFlow. And they have a ringle reduce, they use nickel exactly the same, but this is not yet ready, this is going to be developed. They bring it together with a package, and now I think there is okay, don't have it there, but there is TF distribute now, and this is part of TensorFlow. And they give support now for something called mirrored strategy, which is a multi-GPU, single node training. And they have this collective or reduce strategy, which is exactly what we were talking about here. But the thing is that it's not yet finished. It's something under development. And right now, it requires a bit of work, because different to Horobot, you need to set up an environment variable before doing running. But the tricky thing is that this environment variable has to have the rank of the worker on it. So when you do a run Python MyScript, you have to insert somehow this definition here. And somehow you have to do some logic so the worker in the worker zero, this value is zero. In the worker one, this value is one, and so on. And so this is a bit of setup that at least with Slurm is a bit hard to do. And I added an example. We have an example on the lab material. We're not going to run it here, but you can have a look how to run it. It's a bit it's not complicated, but it's not as nice as Horobot, because you have to use something called some feature from Slurm called multiprog that allows you to do by hand different runs. When you do a run, they allow you to do different executables or different runs per rank. And this is how you can set this value here, okay? And so the script has it has an explanation also, but it has some scripts that do the setup for you, and then you run it. But it's only for two nodes. It's a bit hard to scale. Not too hard, but it's a bit hard to scale. But yeah. Also, the API as part of this, that is still under development, to work with the collective or reduce, is not extended to all TensorFlow. I don't think you can use it now with Keras, And I think you can use it with estimator API. In every fashion of estimator API, you have to use specific functions of estimator API. But absolutely, it's a thing that if you are into this, you have to follow up, and you have to see the development. And the goal, they say, is to have as less code change as possible. But anyway, the two things are recommended, no? Also, there is a Cray a great package that does is very similar to Horobot. The API is different, but the steps are the same, and you can find some information. There is a module, it's called in Cray PE ML plugin. It's called like this, a Cray PE ML plugin. And you can find some information about it here. After you know Horobot and you know how it works, the steps you need to do on the API, learn this is going to be simpler for you, but it's the same as Horobot, okay? In principle, so it's something that you can look if you want. I wanted to talk about it, but I think I prefer it to have it simpler. And although they want to involve as little code modification, so we saw, for instance, the thing of the learning rate. So there are always things that you have to change, because as he pointed out, it's a different algorithm. So always you have to go inside and tune some things, okay? And now we have time already for the break. Yes, we have the break, but before we will do some labs. We start not with this one. Just let me go to the. So I skipped one just to do not lose time connecting to Python to Jupyter. So we are going to do this one in Jupyter. So if you can log in Jupyter before going to the break, and so you can leave it alone and have a look time to time. We can save some time. And here we are going to do we're going to work with the script that generates this. So now you can play with the batch size and. And it's going to be, I think, interesting. And later, you will do the same with Horobot, and you will see the effect of every step of the not doing this. If you do the sync of the initial step, or you don't do it, you will see what happens. You will see what happens if you don't wrap the optimizer into the Horobot optimizer. And I think it's going to be quite nice to understand why you're doing the things with Horobot beyond what I explained. So connect. We are going to distribute to tell you a link to the labs, and it's on the event page. Okay, you can find the exercises on the event page, and enjoy the break. See you in
20 minutes.
20 minutes.